Hey everybody, it's Pastor Greg.
And Pastor Yolanda.
On behalf of the Celebration Spiritual Center family, we want to wish you a very happy new year.
Yes, happy new year. Have an amazing, prosperous, limitless year.
And because we are in a new year, that means we're in a new month, and we have a new message series, Law and Principle, Creative Intent. And this month, we're going to be using the book Asking It Is Given by Esther and Jerry Hicks to support the series. So for those who are not local, for those who are out of town and watching us around the world, go out and get the book. It will support you with this series. Now let's get into the message. And that's your power. That's your greatness. And when we appeal to the sweet spirit, to the Holy Spirit, to the mighty spirit, to the loving spirit, we're appealing to that which is within us, that which empowers us, that which is greater than what we see out here in the world. Good morning, Celebration Spiritual Center.
Good morning.
How's everybody feeling?
Good.
Happy New Year yet again. 2015, it feels so good. It feels so good. So as Roy has already shared with us, we have a new message series, Law and Principle, Creative Intent. And, you know, I had a lot of thoughts about this series and sort of why we're doing this series and the way that we're doing it in this month. Because I recognize that as we're in a new year, one of the things that's important to me is to kind of bring us back to what is true. We talk about a lot throughout the year, you know, 12 months, 12 different series. But what I believe to be true is that if we can grasp and hold on to these fundamental principles, these fundamental universal laws, that is the thing that will transform our life, and we can really, one, understand our lives, and we can understand the lives of our loved ones and what's happening in our world. And so I recognize that it was needed to bring a foundational series that would focus on universal law and principle. And so that immediately took me to the teachings of Abraham, because I just think what Abraham has to say is just incredibly on point and incredibly necessary for this time. What's interesting about the teachings of Abraham, as brought to us through Esther and Jerry Hicks, is that Abraham is really the influential teacher. Every other teacher, modern teacher, that teaches about the law of attraction and these principles, listen to, study Abraham. That's how we got the secret. Rhonda Byrne was a huge, follower of Abraham and listening to Abraham's teachings. And the original version of the secret included Abraham, was later removed. But in terms of contemporary culture, Esther and Jerry Hicks have been doing this work since the early 80s. Wayne Dyer, I mean, the list goes on. All of these teachers will say, yeah, when I found Abraham, that's what rocked my world. That's what changed everything for me. So I thought it was important to go to this work. And Abraham focuses on three principles. And if we understand these three laws, we'll be good. So what's the first law? The law of attraction. And the law of attraction simply says that which is like itself is drawn, right? Then there's the second law, the law of deliberate creation. And what the law of deliberate creation essentially says is that you are a creator and you can be, do, or have whatever you want. That life doesn't have to happen haphazardly or randomly or by default. You can deliberately be, do, or have whatever you want. And then the third law, which some would say could be the most challenging, is the law of allowing. And Abraham says that freedom is the basis of all life, and that includes ours. Abraham goes on and says, the law of allowing says that I am as I am, a free being, and I allow other beings to be free as well, knowing that the life that they live cannot create in my experience unless I allow it. And that's an interesting law and an interesting thought, because as soon as we get into this idea about, oh, well, we create our life and we can deliberately create our life and we attract into our life, immediately our minds go to, well, what about those people across the street that get on my nerves? You know, I don't know how this works. I mean, if I'm attracting that into my experience, they're bothering me, all these other things. But the law of allowing is this perfect place where we get to, where we recognize, because I am a free being, because freedom is the basis of my experience and I have the freedom to create the life that I choose, so does my neighbor across the street. So does my brother. So does my sister. So do my kids. So whoever it may be. So does my partner, right? And we'll delve into that deeper later in the month. But what's important to me is to start at the beginning, because unless we understand this first law, the law of attraction, the next two, they don't make any sense. They don't work, right? So I heard Julie Andrews singing in my head, let's start at the very beginning, right? And so we're going to go to the very beginning. And interestingly enough, when I thought about that, going to the beginning, it took me to the Bible, to the beginning of the Bible, the book of Genesis. And the thing I love about the book of Genesis, and I believe I've shared this before, but you know, there's so many secrets, there's so many hidden codes within Genesis that I love, even in the name Genesis. The root of that word Genesis is the genes of Isis. That the book of Genesis is this powerful origin story that's pointing back to these deeper ideas or more mystical ideas that we would get from Egypt, that we would get from Kemet. The genes of Isis, now we know that Isis is the mother. Isis is considered the mother of all. And so that's why this book would be called or named after the mother of all, Genesis, the genes of Isis. And of course, you know, we have the wonderful story that we all know about Adam and Eve in the book of Genesis. And I wanted to touch on this briefly. I received a message on Facebook. Someone had listened to a message recently and wanted to know more about the creation stories. I mentioned that there are two creation stories. And so I'll just touch on that again because I think it's incredibly important as we're sort of framing this book, and particularly the first three chapters. So in the book of Genesis, Genesis 1, we have the 6 days of creation and the seventh day of rest, or the Sabbath, right? And we know that story. God said, let there be light, and there was light. And then God made the waters, and then the animals, and all of these things. And we move down through the story, and then it says, God said, let us make humankind in our image. I love the plurality. Y'all hear that? Let us make man in our image. Powerful. I'll let y'all sit with that. And then it goes on and it says, in the image of God, he created them male and female. And then it was done. That's the end of the story. That's Genesis 1. No Adam, no Eve, no fall, no garden, no snake, no apple, no temptation, no shame, nothing. 7 days, God created everything, plural, God created everything, making humankind, or mankind, depending on which translation you read, in its image. Male and female, because mother, father, God. I'll share this, and I believe we've talked about this. Israel. Is, the I-S, Isis, Ra, the Egyptian sun god of Ra, El, God, Israel, mother, father, God. It's always been right there in the scripture. It's always been right there. So this plurality of let us make humankind in our image, it's there. So that was Genesis 1, and you know that could be creation. That was the basic story of creation as we look at the origin. But there was a need to try to understand try to make meaning of our life, right? Particularly as we live in this dualistic world, right? And that's where the story of Adam and Eve comes in. The eating of the tree introduces duality, the knowledge of good and evil, the knowledge of up and down, the knowledge of opposites, the knowledge of separation, the knowledge of male and female as being opposed, the knowledge of this or that, the knowledge of I want this and I don't want that. That's what the knowledge of good and evil, this eating of this tree, was really all about. And so when we understand that it's an origin story, what it is, it was a way to try to understand what Abraham would call contrast. And what that simply means is just, we have preferences in our lives. We can, you know, listen to a piece of music and we just don't like it, right? You know, or there's just a certain artist that many people may love. I don't know, Taylor Swift, right? People love Taylor Swift. I don't get it, personally, right? I don't, right? Contrast, right? I ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. Some people, I'm not calling her good or evil, some people love Taylor Swift, right? And others just don't get it, right? And we needed to understand that. And it happens on deeper levels because, you know, when we look at the story in the Garden of Eden, Adam and Eve were kicked out of the garden because they believed or thought that they were naked, right? After they ate of the tree, it says that they saw that they were naked and ashamed and they cover themselves, right? They cover themselves with fig leaves. And we have that wonderful moment where God is walking through the garden in the evening, and he's looking for Adam and Eve, and he's like, where are you? And they're like, oh, well, we hid ourselves from you because we were naked. And God asks, well, who told you that you were naked? Just powerful, right? And so I recognize that the reason that they were kicked out of the garden is because they saw each other as an other, right? They all of a sudden they felt that they needed to be ashamed of each other when really they were one. They were made in the likeness and image of God, God being male and female as well. And so there was unity in Adam and Eve, Adam being the I am, Eve being the I have. They became fearful. They no longer knew who they really were, made in the image and likeness of God. They forgot this thing. And that is the reason why they could no longer stay in the garden. But the good news for me, and what we want to talk about today, is that although Adam and Eve may have been kicked out of the garden in this symbolic, allegorical story, metaphorical story, the truth is that the garden still exists. This is powerful. Oh my God, this is so powerful. Because, see, the story was told to us that because of what Adam and Eve did or did not do, that we're all doomed, that we have no access to any of our power, that although Adam and Eve may have been created in the likeness and image of God, we have no access to that, right? But the garden still exists. So what is the garden? And this is where we get into the teachings of Abraham. Abraham calls it the stream of well-being. The stream of well-being, and I want to share this. Abraham says this, well-being is the basis of this universe. Well-being is the basis of all that is. It flows to you and through you. You have only to allow it like the air you breathe. You have only to open, relax, and draw it into your being. Do you understand how beloved you are, how blessed you are, how adored you are, and what an integral part of this creative process you are? We want you to. We want you to begin to understand the blessed nature of your being, and we want you to begin to look for the evidence of it, because we are showing it to you in every moment that you will allow yourselves to see it. In the lining up of lovers, money, fulfilling experiences, and beautiful things for you to see. In the lining up of circumstances and events, and in the lining up of amazing co-creative experiences where you are rendezvousing with one another for no other reason than for the fantastically important reason of fulfilling, satisfying, and pleasing yourself and giving yourself joy in the moment.
Yes, yes.
Your motion forward is inevitable. It must be. You cannot help but move forward, but you are not here on a quest to move forward. You are here to experience outrageous joy. That is why you are here. Lord, have mercy. Can we breathe that in? Just breathe. Breathe that in. Your motion forward is inevitable. It must be. But you are not here on a quest to move forward. You are here to experience outrageous joy. That is why you are here. And when we think about the metaphor of the garden, we understand that the garden represented outrageous joy. Life was so easy for Adam and Eve. They had everything they needed. They lived in absolute beauty, absolute abundance. Everything that they needed was there, and they had a personal relationship with the power, with their creator, with that which created them. And what's interesting is when they were kicked out of the garden, that's when the hard life shows up, right? Based on the story, okay, well, because you don't know who you are, now you have to till the soil. Because you don't know who you are, now you're going to experience pain in childbirth. Because of you don't know who you are, all of these horrible things are going to happen, and life is going to be tough, and it'll be tough for your children and your children's children. That's what happens when we leave the garden, but we recognize that the garden exists, this well-being exists, which is the basis of the universe, and that is why we are here, to experience outrageous joy. Have you ever considered that? Have you ever considered that, that you're here to just experience outrageous joy, right? Not to attain certain things or achieve certain things or, you know, check off certain boxes and all of these things and, you know, get this degree and that certification. And that's not why you're here. All of that is good. All of that is wonderful. All of that is powerful. All of that is a means to an end. But that's not why we're here. Because again, according to this allegorical, metaphorical origin story, we were created and placed in the garden of well-being. We were created and put into this place, into the stream that's like the air we breathe. We only have to open, relax, and draw it into our being. So we have the law of attraction. The law of attraction says that which is like itself is drawn. It simply says that whatever I am being in this moment, that's what I must experience and attract in my life. We're like magnets. We're constantly attracting who we are into our life. We are vibrational beings, and we are giving and receiving all the time. Abraham would say we're like receivers or transmitters. That there's a part of us, you know, we can think of, you know, a radio station or how television is broadcast. That, you know, we're receiving information as if we were television, but at the same time, we're broadcasting. This is the reason why you can be in a room and somebody will walk in and you just sense, you feel that someone walked in the room, right? Why is that? Because we are vibrational beings. You felt their vibration. You felt their vibration and you knew that they were there. This is the reason why somebody can be on your mind and the phone rings and they call you, oh, just thinking about you. Right, because we're vibrational beings. That thought transmitted to them, sent the word out, oh, let me call Greg. And they call, boom. You know, sometimes we think that's coincidence. I love the word synchronicity. But what we understand is that as vibrational beings, we have the power to transmit and sing and communicate. It's one of the reasons why I love singing with David and Yolanda. We're talking all the time while we're singing, right? Because we're feeling each other and we're in that vibration. So when we talk about vibration, what are we talking about? The best way to understand our vibration is to understand our emotions. If Abraham is saying that there's a stream of well-being that's flowing all the time and that we're here really to experience outrageous joy, then the way to understand what we are vibrating at any moment is to check in with our emotions. How are we feeling? Because when we're feeling outrageous joy, when we're feeling good, when we're feeling satisfied, when we're feeling worthy, when we're feeling just good, right? We know that we're in that stream. And when I say feeling good, it's not about a jumping up and down, oh, my favorite team just won the Super Bowl kind of. That's not it, right? Because sometimes, you know, I mean, one, that's fleeting. That end of the scale doesn't last, right? But it's that sense of all is well, right? It's that sense of just there's peace no matter what. There's ease no matter what. I feel good no matter what, right? No matter what's going on, there's just a constant within you that just can't be shaken, that can't be disturbed, that can't be deterred. That's that place, right? And Abraham would call that being in alignment with your inner being, with the truth of who you are, with the source of who you are. And so we recognize that when we talk about vibration, the way you can know what you're vibrating, how you're vibrating, do you feel fear? Or do you feel good? Do you feel worry? Or do you feel at ease? Right? Are you scared about something? You know, I think about it often without fail. Anytime if there's something I'm endeavoring to do and I introduce fear about what could happen or what might happen, right? I'm vibrating at that level. And sure enough, without hesitation or without reservation, I attract that very thing that I was afraid of, that I didn't want to happen. But it shows up because of my vibration. And I think this is interesting because one of the things that we really want to get to understanding this month is how are we creating what we don't want? Because so often if we want a certain job, right, and we've set our sights on that job and we feel that we've done all that we need to do and we're qualified, but then it doesn't happen. Right, and it's like, well, why didn't that happen? You know, because I was feeling good, Pastor Greg. You told me I got to feel, and I was feeling joy. Why didn't that happen? Right, but we got to understand, and we got to get underneath that and look at what else were we feeling or believing or really thinking in our beliefs that was countering that, that was actually blocking the stream of well-being. Because our job is only to just lower the resistance to well-being. Well-being always is. Again, it's like the air we breathe. We don't have to wait for well-being to show up. We don't have to wait for goodness to show up. We don't have to wait for abundance to show up. It's here. We only have to allow it. Interesting. So that actually takes me to the title of the book that we're using, Ask and It Is Given. Ask and It Is Given. And I love that because that points to the words that we've heard from Jesus, right? Ask and it shall be given. Seek and ye shall find. Knock and the door will be open, right? And what's interesting about that is, you know, you hear those words from Jesus and it's like, all right, man, well, you know, I asked when I was 5 years old and it was not given. You know, I asked last year and it was not given, right? I knocked on the door and the door stayed shut, right? So what are you saying? Like, I don't understand how this is truth. And what I love, how Abraham really deals with this, I think is perfect because What we understand, what Abraham teaches and what we come to understand is that we are always asking, right? That it's not even about taking a specific time to sit down and pray and say, oh, I want this, or I want that. It's not even about taking specific time to write down and say, you know, this is what I want to experience, or this is what I want to do in my life, or doing a vision board. All of those things are a form of asking. But what Abraham tells us, which is so true, is that as we're living our lives, we're asking. Because we're in this place of contrast. We're in this place of duality. So if you go on a date and it's really bad, you know, okay, I never want to go out on a date with this type of person again. You've asked. And what's beautiful is we have this garden that still exists. Your perfect partner is sitting there in the garden waiting for you to allow the stream of well-being to flow through, right? When you're in a job that just is driving you mad, your boss is driving you mad, you just do not want to be here, and you know, this doesn't serve me, and this is not my purpose, and all of these things, right? Immediately, you're asking in that moment, and it's created in that moment, the thing that you want. This is why Jesus can say, ask and it shall be given, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be open, because it already exists. But why doesn't it exist in our physical experience? That's the allowing part. That's the allowing part. That's the part where we have to open ourselves up, just like if we open our mouths, our nostrils, to breathe in air. Spiritually, we have to begin to open ourselves up to receive what already exists and knowing it from that perspective, right? Because I think what we think many times that when we're asking for something or we want to manifest something or we want to create something, the thought is that we're trying to create something that doesn't already exist because we don't see it with our physical eyes in the material world. But see, the spiritual world doesn't work like that. Because if I say, think of an airplane, it exists in your mind now. The airplane is there. And each of you may have thought of different things. Some may have thought of a 747. Some may have thought of a Cessna. Some may have thought of a toy airplane. Whatever it may be, the airplane exists in thought, in your mind right now. So at any moment when you have a preference about something, at any moment when something causes you to desire something different, it already exists. The garden exists. And again, I think this is powerful to understand because then you recognize that you're not asking for something that's not already here. You're not trying to, oh, please pull out of the ethers, you know, millions of dollars. Your $1 million already exists. Your perfect partner already exists. Your perfect career already exists. Your dream vacation already exists. All of that thing exists now. So then what we're doing vibrationally and spiritually, then we're just lining up with it, which is about the allowing part. We're getting to that space of recognizing, oh, it already exists. And so my only job now is to release anything that's in resistance to that. My job is to focus on outrageous joy. Because that which you desire can only come when we're focused on that joyful, that loving, that all is well place. And so this is then where and why we must become selfish about what we allow into our space and our spirit. You know, the news, you can watch it if you want to, right? But here's the thing. The news is telling one story, right? The news tells us a story about lack, limitation, doubt, fear, not enough. All of these, that's just what the news, that's its purpose. God bless them. That's what it does, right? And so it's absolutely impossible to be focused on that, but then also be focused on the things that we say we want, the things that feel good, the things that we want to show up in our lives, the things that represent outrageous joy, the things that represent ease in our life, the things that represent freedom. They're on two opposite poles. I've used this example before, and this is something that Abraham uses often. It's tuning to a radio station. If you're tuned to the country western station, you can't be tuned to Hot 97 and listening to hip-hop at the same time. You just can't. And you can talk all day long about, yeah, you know, I really want to hear some hip hop. I heard about a new Nicki Minaj song or whatever it may be, right? You could say all of that. You can talk about it. You can really want it. But until you turn the dial away from the country and western station, you're not going to hear hip hop. And so this is why we become careful. Right, in the sense that we just don't allow certain things in our space. And I promise you, whatever it is that you need to know from the news, it'll come to you. It really will. I'm a living, breathing example of it. Whatever you need to know, you will not be ill-informed. Because, you know, that was me. I mean, you know, I loved, you know, my political news, and I wanted to be up on everything and be able to speak and debate articulately about the issues. All of that, right? You know, I don't want to, you know, I want people to know that I know something. Right? But, right? But the problem became that, you know, I would start my morning, I'd turn on NBC in the morning, and I'd have the TV on so I could hear it in the shower and while I'm getting dressed. And you know, one day it was like the news, it was just like, you know, all these people were killed in a fire, and then this happened. And I'm like, I'm getting ready to go to work, and I feel terrible. I feel awful. I'm hearing all of this. And I just stopped. I said, I can't do it. I have my phone. My phone will tell me the weather. That's all I really need to know. You know, do I need an umbrella or not? Do I need a heavy coat? Like, and everything else will come. It really will come. And what's beautiful, I remember I was having a conversation with my dad. I think this was a couple of years ago. And, you know, we were talking about different things. And he started telling me about a story about some kids that had drowned in this bus. And it was And it was fascinating to me because I didn't know anything about it. It was like, he was like, oh, you didn't hear about it? It was a huge story. And I was like, no, I don't know anything about it. But I felt so good that I didn't know about it because it meant that I was living in this free space of not allowing that to bog me down, not allowing that to be the stuff that I create from, right? Because at the point that becomes news, there's nothing that you can do about that, right? A tragedy like that, you're just going to sit in, oh, this is so terrible, and oh, the babies, and oh, you know, I've heard people talking about the missing plane recently, and you know, it's a tragedy. We send so much love to the families that are mourning, you know. But at this point, there's nothing tangible that we can do except we want to do something for the families, if there's something that we can do tangibly for them. But our being in a place of despair and sorrow, that's not going to allow us to create what it is that we want. If we want to move from that place and move to an inspired idea, we got to be in that joyful place. What would love do? We got to go to that loving place and say, well, what in this moment, how can I be love in this moment? But that's a different radio station, right? That's a different channel. You can't be there and in sorrow at the same time. So how do we know that we're in the garden? And I talked about our emotions. Abraham says that we have an emotional guidance system. And we've talked about this in the message the last summer, Bless You Fear. We went up the scale, right? The emotional guidance system. And it's the way that you can feel and know where you are in the stream of well-being. Because we understand that emotions are absolutely good. I love every emotion, positive or negative, right? Because when we're angry, when we're in doubt, when we're in worry, when we're in fear, that is just simply an indication to us that we are not in alignment with the things that we say we want. That's all. So whatever it is, all of this asking that we've been doing, we've been asking, it's created. It exists in the realm of mind, and all is mind, in this garden that we're talking about. It exists. And so at any moment that we're feeling a negative emotion, again, fear, doubt, worry, despair, depression, all of these things, that's just telling us that we're not on the same station as the things that we say we want, right? So we have that wonderful guiding system. And so we recognize that then we can feel our way back into the garden. We can feel our way back into this place of abundance. We can feel our way back into this place of beauty. We can use a simple process, pivoting, right? Just allowing ourselves to just think about a different thought, just for a moment, right? Another one I love that Abraham says, if you can, go to sleep. Just take a nap. Has anybody ever done that? Like sometimes things were just really crazy. And it was like, I just need to go to sleep. I just take a nap. Or you just decide to go to bed early. Like, you know, things are just crazy. I'm just going to bed early. Tomorrow's a new day. What that does, that actually resets us, right? And then we have a choice in the new day to either go back to the old station or to start at this new station. We're back in complete alignment at the beginning of every day, which is powerful. So, and I love that, right, that we have this 24-hour process. It's almost like, you know, a movie like Groundhog Day, or if you've seen Edge of Tomorrow, Live, Die, Repeat, which I love, right? That idea of we always get this beautiful reset. We get this beautiful reset, and every day we have a choice. Are we going to do the same thing or a new thing? But what I love is at the beginning of the day, when you open your eyes, you are in complete alignment with everything you've been asking for. And so then it's only our choice, as I talked about. So, I wake up in the morning. I used to wake up in complete alignment, and then what would I do? Turn on doubt and fear and scary news, right? Took me right out. I tuned to a different station. And so then my day is going to flow from that place. So there's other things that we can do. We can take the time. We can sit quietly at the beginning of our day, recognizing that we're already in alignment. Let me just feel this alignment. 5 minutes, 10 minutes. Let me just feel that. Sit in meditation, right? We had the beautiful meditation this month. Breathe, right? Sitting in that, right? We can make it a game. For those who may be skeptical about this thing, right? And this is a beautiful month to just try it out, right? You can just set the intention that, you know what? I'm going to get a free cup of coffee today. I don't know how, I don't know when, but I'm just going to set the intention as I'm in alignment now. And I realize Pastor Greg is saying all I have to do is just focus on joy. Just think happy thoughts, right? And let's see what happens, right? Or you can set a smaller intention. Maybe, set a number. This is great. Just say like five strangers will speak to you and smile where that normally never happens, like on the subway. Let's say that, because people don't talk on the subway, right? Everybody's into their own thing. But you can set that intention. For those who read E-squared and studied that with us year before last, and there's the sequel, E-cubed, that's out now, you can set the intention to see cars of a certain color, like just all day. I'm gonna see yellow cars. And then just let it go. What's powerful, I loved when I did that experiment, I think it was beige cars, and I was walking down Flatbush Avenue, and I was looking for my first beige car, and you know, I was seeing every color but beige, and finally I saw the first beige car, and I'm like, wow, okay. You know, but that could be a coincidence, right? That just, beige cars. And then, not long after that, a few seconds later, another beige car shows up, and it's like, okay, maybe this thing is real, you know. I went about my day, went about my business, and really wasn't thinking about it anymore. I got on the subway, I get off, I'm walking home, and I walk onto this block, and there are only four cars on the block. Every car was beige. And it was scary, right? It was like, you know, I know this stuff is real, but in that moment, it was just like, you know, right? So it can be something just small like that, because that beautiful experiment that Pam Grout brought to us is, the heart of it was, you know, she has these a group of experiments to prove that we actually create our reality, that we create our life. So this is the law of attraction. That which is like unto itself is drawn. You are vibrational beings vibrating all the time. You are always asking, and everything that you ask for, it exists immediately when you ask for it. Again, how do you know? Think a thought right now. Think of Mickey Mouse. There he is. Right? Think of a skyscraper. There it is. And each of you has your own unique individual skyscraper that looks like, you know, it could look like a skyscraper here in New York. It could look like some of the amazing buildings across the world. It exists in thought, right? And we understand first principle from the Kabbalion, all is mind, all is thought. That's where everything is. That's where everything comes from. So if it already exists, and we're not trying to beg and plead for something that doesn't exist that we think we're not worthy of, or we're trying to be good enough to get it, you know, like we were kids with Santa Claus. Oh, let me be good for like the last couple months of the year so I can make sure that I get what I want. It's not that kind of thing. It already exists. And then you can be, do, or have whatever you want. You can ask for whatever you want, right? So there's no limit. There's no ceiling. And that must be true, otherwise our world wouldn't have expanded in the way that it has, right? It's interesting to think about, you know, Malcolm was here for the Christmas holiday, and we were talking about the movie Back to the Future, which she loves and I love as well. And what's interesting about it is that when they went to the future in Back to the Future 2, they went to the year 2015. And so there's an article talking about, well, what did they get right? But what's interesting to me, when we think about this time that we live in, all of the asking that created the life that we enjoy, all of the asking that had to happen for us to have an iPad or an iPhone or Android phones and the Samsung Note and the S5 and all of this wonderful technology, all of the asking that had to happen for us to have the internet and be able to communicate in the way that we do, the way we can stay connected, all of the asking. In that movie, they had video phones. We have FaceTime. We have all of these different ways to communicate and see each other. All of the asking that created this world. And again, it had to be outside of the realm of what we saw. It was a desire. You know, oh, it would be so good. How many? I know we've all said that. It would be so good if somebody would dot, dot, dot. You know, create a new broom to do this. Or so it would be cool if somebody would do, or the proverbial they would dot, dot, dot. Just in that moment, that's contrast, that's preference. There's an ask. It exists. And then we as humanity get to rise up to that level to allow it to be. And so when these new things come out, or new ways of thinking, new ways of being, you know, I loved hearing about in the state of Maryland that there's no more death penalty in the state of Maryland, and the governor commuted the sentences of the last four people who were on death row. Think about the asking that was created for the death penalty to be abolished in a state, for the governor to say that one, capital punishment is not cost effective. Two, capital punishment does not deter murders. And three, this is not in alignment with the values of us as the people of the state of Maryland. Those were his words, right? Think about the asking that had to be created for that to become a reality, right? And state by state, states are starting to abolish it because it doesn't make sense. Not to mention the fact that you have so many people on death row that actually didn't commit the crimes, right? All of the asking that was required. And so for me, one of the reasons that I think this series is so important, as people are still protesting and doing die-ins in the mall and all of these things, what I know to be true is that understanding these principles is how we will create the world that we want. If we really want equality, if we really want peace, if we really want all of these things, if we want to change the environment, if we want better schools, if we want better housing, if we want to end homelessness, if we want to have any of these things, we got to understand these principles. We got to understand first law of attraction, that each and every one of us are attracting into our lives exactly what we're being. So if we want a different experience, that means we have to be different, right? It's not about making signs and rah, 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 and fighting against the people and talking about the NYPD and all of this stuff, right? Because we've already seen just in recent history, recent moments, that when we're in that pushing against place, that's then what gets other people killed. When we're in that place of resistance, right? You can't talk about what you want and what you don't want. I know that a lot of people have said, oh, well, you can criticize, you know, talk about police brutality and criticize the police while still respecting them. Those live on two different stations, as far as I'm concerned, right? And as far as we're talking about law of attraction, it's on two different stations. Because we live in an inclusive universe. I say it often, the universe only says yes and amen. So when we say, you know, we're marching against police brutality, right? It's we're including police brutality in our vibration. So police brutality continues. When we march against racism, racism still stays within the vibration. So that means that we have to, if we're going to march, if we're going to protest, we have to march only and protest only for what we want, not against anything. Because then we're not including that in our vibration. And so so this is why we're doing this series, because if we get to this foundational place of understanding these three universal laws, then we can create our lives as we want, and we can create the world that we want. And so on that, I invite everybody to stand. And I'm looking forward to digging a little deeper. We're going to do some things differently this month. We're going to do a Q&A, a week-long Q&A next week. Ask me anything. It'll be via Facebook and Twitter. Any questions that you have about these laws that, okay, this sounds really good, but how does it work in this situation? Or, well, what does it mean in the book when it says this or that? We're going to really open it up, because I believe that it's important and necessary for us to begin to teach this in a different way and offer it to a wider group of people. So those who are on Facebook, look for that event. It's going to be out there. Invite as many people as you want, anyone that you think may be interested and want to participate. And all week, we're just going to talk and chat. And no question is limited, because This is the only way that we can ultimately understand these principles. This is the only way that we can ultimately understand what we're talking about. So with that, Mother, Father, God, we are grateful to begin this journey. We are grateful to remember that the garden exists. We are grateful to remember that there is a stream of well-being that is always flowing, that flows to us easily and effortlessly, just like the air we breathe. We are grateful to know that this stream of well-being, it's the foundation of the universe. It's abundance itself. It's prosperity itself. It's wealth itself. It is more than enough. It is always enough. It is beauty itself. It is expansive and it is creative. And it is our very home. And not only is it a place that we live in, but it lives in us. We live, move, and have our being in it as it has its being and moves in us. And we are grateful to recognize that we simply have to allow it to be. Because we hear the words of truth, ask and it shall be given, seek and ye shall find, knock and the door shall be open. And we understand here and now that that asking happens on a regular basis, that as we are living life, we are asking. But beyond that, we understand that that ask creates immediately, that that thought creates in mind immediately. And so we find so much relief in knowing that we are no longer trying to squeeze out life or squeeze out the things that we want from life, but we recognize that we are simply allowing that which already exists to be. So we can say to each and every desire of our heart, we can say to each and everything that we want to be, we can say to each and everything that we want to have, it is done. Collectively, we say it now with our voices. I encourage each and every one to say it right now. To whatever it is that you want to be, to do, or have, it is done.
It is done.
It is done because it exists already. It is done.
It is done.
It is done because you have thought and called it into being. It is done.
It is done.
And so we will move into a greater understanding of our power as creators. We will move into a greater understanding of this power that has been endowed to us, that is the same power that we see in our Creator. And we will move through life victorious. We will move through this life glorious. We will move through this life standing in our magnificence and our significance. For this, we are so grateful. We lift up our voices and we say, amen.
Amen.
Ashe.
Ashe.
And so it is.
So it is.
Thank you, God.